Rickon here for Hollywood First Look. Today, I'm talking with Dr. Anthony Ocampo, and we are talking the documentary White Hot, The Rise and Fall of Abercrombie and Fitch. Let's take a first look.
You know that you're getting close.
When you're hit with the smell of Abercrombie.
The nightclub beats and bare-chested guys.
It was such a pop culture phenomenon.
It was an all-American look, and I considered myself an all-American girl.
Oh, make me over.
Abercrombie and Fitch said, we go after the cool kids. If they didn't look a certain way, they didn't belong in our clothing. Are we exclusionary? Absolutely.
So I wanted to know, what was your reaction to the documentary? Because I know that you knew your portion, but how about the overall story?
Oh, I mean, first off, what I really felt good about was that the other plaintiffs, I hadn't seen them in almost 20 years. And so it really meant something to hear their stories. And it really meant something for me to hear that the way they told the story was exactly the same as they told it back in the year 2000, which just goes to show you that this thing really happened, right? There was no exaggeration whatsoever. And so that was my first reaction. Number two, I was actually quite surprised to learn that there was some weird Abercrombie headquarters that was predominantly white and tried to do all these other things behind the scenes to perform improvement when it comes to diversity, but in reality wasn't actually doing it. And so I was also surprised that at no point, whether it was our case or the case of the Muslim woman, there was no apology ever.
How long did that take from start to finish for you? Because it's not like you sit there and do a complaint and then, oh, next year there's a result and you know, and there's a $40 million settlement.
Yeah, that's a great question. And it's actually a question I've never been asked. So I'm happy to narrate the timeline. First year of college, December 1999, I go back to LA where I live and I get a job at the Glendale Galleria seasonal job.
Oh, wow. It was here. Oi, I'm in LA. So yeah, Glendale Galleria. Okay.
And you know, the Glendale Galleria, it's not necessarily the most white mall in the world.
Right, exactly.
So I got a job there and I worked there for a couple of weeks. And then my manager said, you know, you can come back. And then the following summer, I tried to do that. And that's when they told me. It was summer 2000 at this point. I'm sorry, we can't rehire you because we already have too many Filipinos working at this store.
So then was that woman, because, like, you know, I watched the doc. Was she white that told you that?
Oh, my gosh. She was Hapa.
Oh, see, but that's good though. That's why she told you that, you know, but that's crazy. You know, otherwise, cause I was thinking about someone's white or they wouldn't tell you that. So is it, or like, you must've really probed to get that answer. So the fact that she's at least one of us to say, like, listen, this is what's up. And I don't have the power to battle against them. So, okay. Keep going.
No, sorry, that's sorry. Actually a really good perspective. I didn't even think about it that way, but absolutely. Maybe there was this shared camaraderie of, like, you know, let me let them in into what was actually said. It was in my senior year of college in 2003 that stuff started to move forward.
Oh, wow. So at this point, from that time that you went, so it's 4 years later.
It's 4 years later.
But even before the lawsuit. Okay.
Yeah. Literally, my mom just told me, oh, you don't remember the day after graduation, we had to drive straight down to LA so you could be in one of the Abercrombie related things. So yeah, in 2003, that's what happened. And there was a number of, you know, media appearances we did and 60 Minutes, CNN. And then at some point, the lawsuit settled for, as you can see, $40 million and then another maybe like $7 million in legal fees. And then, you know, that was 2004. And to be honest, I really didn't talk much about it for the next like decade and a half, in part because, I mean, it wasn't that I was hiding it. It just never really came up in conversation. So I have a lot of friends that are like, I never knew this about you. How come you never shared this? I think what the documentary didn't capture is that we did a lot of Latin American media, Spanish language channels. I did Filipino media. So, and then the Asian American candidates did, for example, like Chinese local newspapers. So it was really an opportunity for us to share that this racist thing was happening. And it was a pattern across the nation.
White Hot, The Rise and Fall of Abercrombie and Fitch is streaming on Netflix now.
They literally made so much money.
Exclusion was the root of their success.
They had a no headscarf policy.
Abercrombie went all the way to the Supreme Court.
All American doesn't mean all white.
Abercrombie knew that they had a lot to hide. We have some really troubling behavior.
The story was an indictment of where our culture was.
They didn't invent evil. They didn't invent class. They just packaged it.